I am going to mainly talk about the visual presentation skills part of it. By the way, this session was scheduled in week number, chapter number 6 in the last FDP when we had this. So people who are faculty associates will remember this session pretty much in the end of the course. But there was a feedback about the need to have this earlier in the course is the reason why we have pushed it right in the beginning now. And the other allied advantage of doing this is that whatever contents now you will create in due course of time will have these visual presentation skills embedded into it. That's the motive by which we have done this. So without further delays, let me just begin with this slide. You must have seen in the videos, but for those who have not seen the video, then also for those as a repeat telecast, I will brush through this slide. I wanted to stress upon this point of plan, execute, and impress as the methodology for any presentation to be given out. Now, when I say presentation, I don't mean only a slide presentation as such. I am taking it in a bigger sense. It could be a paper, research paper, it could be your own website, it could be various things, whatever you want to communicate through. So if that is the motivation, then typically it happens so that we have seen lot of, especially students, doing this mistake of going from right to left in the slide. So most of them start with what template to choose, what font to choose, and what color background and all that, and then start keying in their content. And almost towards the end of the timing of that presentation, they start the rearrangement. Okay, this slide is not good here, maybe I'll push it. That's a very odd way of doing it, simply because the channelizing of thoughts are very scattered in your own, first of all. And there are few bullets on a slide which you feel should not be on that and then should be somewhere else. But all these things have happened because of the information chunking not happened at the initial stage. So it finally boils down to that. Lots of queries have come to me about give us some guidelines about what fonts to choose, what colors to choose, because that perennial problem we have. And therefore, this time deliberately I chose to speak in a live session to communicate some flaws and the advantages of choosing these elements in the proper format. That is the reason. So what I suggest is, and I'm not quoting a particular example here, but when I saw some of the WordPress sites, I could realize that many people started by choosing the template and then entering content over it. They never thought about what's the content I have as an individual, because templates are made for a generic usage. So it's like a ready-made shirt versus a tailored shirt. So there is a size 40 and there is a size 39, and you are 39 and a half. So then there is that this is fitting too much and this is loose too much, and then you don't fit into it. So you finally accommodate or adjust to either a Dila shirt or a tight shirt, but then that's what the pros and cons are. But same thing happens with your content creation. So template will be there for a generic usage, but you are supposed to modify that to your needs. So I saw the slide, some websites on WordPress where there were certain links on template which were available readily, but no content was there because the person did not wasn't aware what to put there, because that person was not did not have any content in that probably that tab. So two things could have happened. First is choose a template which has exact mapping over what you are doing, or modify it accordingly. That can happen only when you first do this plan stage. So you brainstorm. So I am just showing couple of techniques here. I am not saying these are cast in stone kind of things, but one of the techniques which I found myself useful and I have tried it with lots of is do a brainstorming. Put in all the ideas you have in your mind on a piece of paper randomly without being judgmental about it. just keep writing whatever comes to your mind when you think of that topic. For example, you are talking about your own website as such. So what all should be there? So just keep writing there. Okay, my slides, my education, my publications, my experience, my personal, whatever. And then keep writing that. Then analyze, like, is it necessary, not necessary? So that is the point where you can be judgmental. Then you organize it. And this is where the crux of the situation is. You will hardly find a template which is created for teachers, or which is created for painters, or which is created for very niche audience, because they will be always generic. So teacher's requirement will be different than a photographer. So you'll see a photography portfolio template, and you try to fit in your content in that. It will look too jazzy, which you don't want. On the other side, there will be a text only type of a template, which will be too bland according to what you wanted to actually say. So this contrast is always a problem, and therefore you should organize the thoughts, whatever you have. That is the point where you do the chunking. So what is my experience? What is my download section? What all will have there? What are the internal linkages between these pages, and why are they there? All that if you create, and I personally choose mind mapping as a tool for that. So once you have a mind map of whatever your thoughts are, I think it is much more clearer to you about how you want to give it out. Once done with that, that gives you an outline of what you have to do. That is where you start the execute phase. And execute phase is where you choose technologies. Okay, now if this is my content, then what should be the technology for that? And then you choose whether WordPress is a good idea, or you want to go with a plain HTML5 thing, or anything else for that matter. And then start adding that into bulleted details, or adding a couple of more information to it. Maybe adding photographs, graphics, your own sketches, or tag clouds, or whatever, the way you want to express your ideas. And the last thing is where you decide on the impress part, where it comes to whether this font is suitable, not suitable, color schemes and typography, and all those things come there. The practice is kept outside because this was about the presentation skills as such, and essentially a lot of people are done with their presentation just few minutes before actually presenting it, and that shows off on stage or screen, wherever it is. So that is why I had just kept it in all caps at the bottom, because that is very important. Anyway, let us go to the next slide, and we'll have a small activity at this point. You all are now familiar with this thing called Think, Pair, Share. Now, at this point, I request the local coordinators to help me out. So the process is like this. We will be announcing a small activity, but the submissions are going to be from every remote center as one submission. So it is not individual, it is not a group, it is not a pair. So I should have actually called it Think, remote center pair, or remote center group, and then share with the entire classroom of all 180 remote centers. So that's the idea. Okay, so I'm trying it on a very mega scale this time, and let's see how it goes about. And this activity is primarily about the point in the plan section which I was emphasizing earlier on, about how to organize your content, whatever content you have. And you can extrapolate these ideas even to a presentation of your own topic and other things. But we'll take a very small, slightly lighter example to demonstrate this. So, all of you, without writing, just by looking at it, if I ask you to look at these set of alphabets and try to remember them, and tell me tomorrow evening, what were these alphabets? Then how will you do that? So next slide. Next slide. Okay. So here is the think question. All of you are now familiar with this think question, pair question, share question, right? So think question is that what techniques can be used in order to memorize these alphabets? So the question to the coordinators at the remote centers is, ask the remote center, I'll give you 2 minutes, ask the remote centers to brainstorm about various techniques they can apply for memorizing this thing, and select one topmost technique, whatever you come up with. And that you have to keep it with yourself till I tell you. Don't start putting it on chat, right? Just keep it with you. I'll give you maybe 2 minutes for this activity, and I'll do that activity here also. So people here, start thinking about techniques of memorizing this set of alphabets. Who is the coordinator here? Or anyone can become a coordinator for the time being. Just start noting down various techniques, whatever the individual benches are telling you. Okay, the query is the sequence important? Answer is, sequence is not important. Go ahead and give your ideas to this gentleman who is having a notebook in his hand and writing down ideas. All remote centers should do this exciting thing of talking in the class idea, okay? I can see from Symbiosis Remote Center that people were very quick in giving multiple correct solutions to this problem, which is definitely the point. So let us go to the next slide. Okay, hold on. So, okay, fine. So have people started? Can you see in the chat if somebody has started putting it? So now what I suggest you is that you can stand here and doubt for your options, or you can just ask people for your one of the option. How many people vote for it? And maximum voting, we will take that as the option of the remote center. Is this fine? Democratic? Okay.
First option is making a meaningful sentence, maybe a song or maybe some meaningful words, or maybe making a slogan out of this. So basic idea is making a meaningful words out of these alphabets. Unanimous. Wow.
Such a democratic place. Okay, so we had a unopposed winner here, and everybody said that make a meaningful set of words out of this thing, right? And I can see that many people are also writing the same thing. Same ideas are echoing out across the country now. Okay, fine, go ahead to the next slide. So everybody agrees to the meaningful words idea, right? I have a small catch there. Okay, so now these are the alphabets. Fine, go ahead. One idea which I think a lot of people wanted to say, but that got dissolved, where you can remember the amount of occurrences, right? So 2E, somebody had said that. Okay, fine. Good. I am happy that I was a slide for these people also. Okay, so so make a set of things, but you can't remember, right? Wo single wale kitne honge, one R, one C, how will you remember? So that is cancelled by unanimous decision. Okay, let's go ahead. So make meaningful words. Okay, how about a naval reciting? It's a meaningful word, right? Out of the same alphabets. Will you be able to remember this by tomorrow evening if I ask you? A naval reciting, okay? Or how about the second one? Vacate, rain, nil. Is this better? Naval is better, okay. Sorry. But start seriously. Will you seriously remember naval reciting? Probably no. And the reason is because this particular alphabet, a set of words, have some disjoint in between. So, go next. How about active learning? Yes. Now, why will you remember active learning over naval reciting? It's because it is related to you, right? So that is where the connect happens. So organization is also there, right? We organized them in meaningful words. They had meaning. Naval has a meaning, reciting has a meaning. Everything is perfectly in place, but it is not connected to you. Therefore, you cannot remember it. Probably a director will remember that naval reciting very well, but not you guys, right? You are teachers. So it depends on the audience. That what they will remember always. So the organization has to cater to the audience. That is making. So just organization is not the sufficient point. It has to be having the relevance part. So context is the point which has to come up in all these organizations. Otherwise, you see beautifully organized things or presentations, but you don't connect with them because of the same problem. So had I given an example here of a famous animator from Disney Studios, his name was organized in this manner, you wouldn't have remembered him at all later on, right? Because it's nothing. And if I say Ram Mohan here, I will remember it because I am an animator, but you may not remember. It's nothing to do. But active learning, if I tell you, tomorrow you will give me all the alphabets and go, right? Without fail. So everybody will pass the test just because of that context was clear. Okay, let's go next. So I am just doing a recap now, a very quick recap of what was covered in the lectures also, the videos. But what was not there were some of the examples. So I would just try to recap that, and maybe some slides I'll skip also now, because I have been told that a lot of people have already seen that. Cracking voice issues, sir. Only one L. Okay. Not clear. Okay. So somebody pointed out a mistake also in my design. So they said only one L in your alphabet and you have shown two L's here. Okay. So who was that? PS College of Engineering in Karnataka. Okay, great. That is what actually I used Internet Anagram Maker for this. And maybe I skipped on something, but good observation. We will go ahead. I have few color schemes and for a word. Now again, that contextuality, now you can see how it applies. And now you can also remember some of the places where it is not appropriate. And you see certain presentations with bizarre colors in that without any context. And therefore you find them not catching your eye, or you can't recall them, or it actually distracts you from what was supposed to be told, right? So which color suits this word basically? How many people will go for the first option? None. One. Okay. Two. Couple of them. Okay. Three. More. And four. Oh, two people still want four. Pink military. Fine. Good. Okay. No, it's jokes apart. It's fine. Go. Let's go next, and it will create a complex problem then. Okay. How many people will go for the first soft? Okay. Second soft. Third soft. And fourth soft. Oh. And how many people don't want any one of these four colors? Okay. So which color do you want? Black. Okay. How many people will go for black for soft? I can't get answer anyway. But here. Okay. How many people black for soft? One. Oh, you are the lone person. Okay, fine. Good. Again, let's go next and I'll answer this point. Okay. First for space. Second for space. Third for space. Oh, green space. Fourth for space. None. Okay. Next, go next. Okay. How many for first neutral? Lot of them, right? Second neutral, some of them. Third neutral, fourth neutral, none of them, right? Okay, so you can easily see it has a lot of, so go next slide. Yes, color schemes carry a huge subjective load on them. What is soft for me may not be soft for you, and vice versa. So when you depict something, especially in academia, please stick to neutrals. So use of color is very, very and very dicey in especially when you are presenting to a audience which is over different cultures and continents and other things, because what will be soft for you in India may not be soft for them in Israel and things like that. So be sure about it, and therefore be safe about it. So but the common guidelines are: more contrast is more readability, definitely. So how many people in this slide can read the color guidelines word here on the top, right? But do you see that first, or see the more contrasting first? More contrasting is first, right? Because I want you to read more contrasting first. Because I'm going to say this word called, I'm telling you color guidelines now. I don't want to waste your time in reading it. But that's the heading, because the template tells me that there should be a heading for every slide. So I'll put some heading. But because I don't want you to pay attention to it so much, I made it gray. So automatically, a lot of people didn't even read what was there. Only when I started asking where is color guideline, they started looking at it. And then they found it. And then I am controlling your point of view now. I am dominating the way you look at my document, and not the way you want to read it. That's the power of how visual presentation skills can be really used in. So you don't allow people to go here and there. You just ask them to follow your script. And that's what you should try and attempt in every design presentation. So more contrast gives you more readability. Of course, that goes without saying. But this is very interesting. Dim lit room will have typically a darker thing. So whenever you present something, if you present what I'm presenting right now, is what is it? It is black text on white, which means that there is a huge white and it is making your pupils dilate a lot if it is a dark room. Fortunately, here a lot of lights are put in, not because of anything else, but they want to project me and capture me, and the camera requires light. So therefore, otherwise in a normal classroom, it will be very dark. Nobody wants to see the teacher. So they all will see the presentation, which is white, and everybody's eyes are dilated. Actually, when we tell our kids don't watch TV in dark, it's basically that reason. But same thing we do when we create presentations and make the kids in the classroom watch the presentations with such a white background, and then they're exposed to it. So when you have such a situation, typically if it is brightly lit room, right, what it is right now, this is a good idea. But when it is a dark room and no lights are on and only the projection is on, typically use the reverse of it, because it will create less amount of stress on the eyes. Lot of people told me that it will create an adverse effect also, because once the dilation is less, it will soon convert into sleeping. So we don't want happen. That is why we keep them on. In fact, one of the analogy given to me was that the slide transitions are a good shock effect for people. Okay, there is a page curl happening, so people just get wake up call and then they start looking at what is the next slide coming up. Okay, jokes apart, we'll go to the next thing. Can you actually see the vivid color, vivid at these points? I tried a lot, but I could not go more vivid than this. Maybe the genes of the artists in me are not allowing me to do that. But yeah, vivid and pale is very important. And that happens typically because we restrict ourselves to the 256 color palette, which is given with every color picker. So we will only choose one of those. And those colors are 256. So they are always vivid colors. It's very difficult to find a neutral color in that. There's no neutral color available. But there is one small tab after all the 256 buttons, which we frequently click on. There is something called custom. Please go to that and select a neutral color, which will be easy on eye for everybody. Right? So that's one essential point. And color scheme to suit your topic. Actually, it's the other way around. Discard the color scheme which are not suitable to your topic. You will end up with a good color scheme any which way. Right, so keep just shooting down colors which are not related to your topic. You will end up with a good color for yourself. Okay. This is my favorite slide. So how many people want to choose the font which I've used for the first one on the military? For military. First one. Some of them. Okay, second one. Slightly more. Third one. No. Fourth one. Okay. There are people who raised hand for two times also. That's okay, because they see that both are fine. Right. Anyone who doesn't want any of these fonts and choose anything on the other side of this thing, you want to use something like third font in the soft for military? None of you, right? Why? Yeah, because military goes for strictness, for uniform and all these things, right? So the fonts should also reflect all these things. So I don't realize why always presentations end with Comic Sans thank you. And so that I really fail to understand. Is it because like I'm too happy to say that the presentation is over or whatever? But that's a common slide I have seen with a smiley on it. And this is a personal expression at the end of the day, which is fine. I am okay with that part. But does it really help in communicating what we are trying to communicate? All this time you are talking about the server management or something, and then suddenly you get a slide with Comic Sans, thank you, and smiley. So it doesn't just go with the flow. That's the point I wanted to tell you. I have read some of them, so let me just see. Okay, so there are a lot of people pushing it. Space for 2 and 4, space for 3. Okay, space for 3 is an interesting choice. I never thought of that. Space 2 and 4 is quite common. Kottayam says for 3. How many go for neutral for 3? Third neutral, okay. How many go for neutral for 4? Absolutely no, right? Let us see if anybody in the chat has done just for the joke part. No, absolutely no, right? Okay. So I think it's one of the sessions which is heavily on the chat right now. Everybody is typing their to the glory, which is good. 1, 2, 4, and 3. Okay, so let me just take that. Tyagaraja College of Madurai. Okay, so 1, 2, first one in military, second in soft, fourth in space, and third in neutral. Do you all agree with this? Oh, good. So Madurai, we all are with you on 1, 2, 4, 3. I think there is another set saying 1, 2, 2, 3. Okay, how about that? So space also is 2 instead of 4. Yeah, and we'll give it to that, right? We don't mind. Fine. But I'll tell you the reason between. Okay, so hold on. This is the interesting point. In space, there is second and fourth, which is having a tie. So most of them are choosing between the two. And let us see what is the big difference in that. Let's go to the next slide. Okay, next slide. Okay, there is one more interesting point left here. I think I have covered this very elaborately in the video also, but nevertheless, I'll just. So the ways of lending emphases are as follows, and you can see them. 1, go next. 2, everybody knows that. To do a bold, to do a italic, to do a underline, right? Or if you are fortunate enough to have a color printer, you can do a color, right? The problem happens when you do this, which is bold, italic, underline, and change of color. Why do we need that, right? It is overemphasized. You can just do this, and a small digression, but an interesting story at this point. How many people are novel readers? They love to read novels, right? And how many people have seen the movies based on those novels? Did you like movie or the novel? How many people like the movie? How many people like the novel? Okay. Why they like the novel? Because the novel gave them their creative liberty to imagine how the villain looks like. Not like Amrish Puri dik jata hai. You have to agree with the fact of the director that, okay, the villain is only like this. So that creative freedom is taken away. But if you observe keenly, all the novels in the world are printed in single font, in single color, right? And still they take you to such colorful locations, bizarre situations, rapid chases. There is no italic with speed lines and all that there. Right? You just write, he was running behind the villain so fast and all that. And you just realize that. It's only because they cut away the other distractions from you and focus on the content what they are trying to tell you. That is where this extra emphasis creates a problem. So never ever do that. If you want things to be emphasized, do it with limited efforts. Don't overemphasize. Go next. I think I'm emphasizing too much on this topic. Let me go next. So here is the guideline slide, which is important. By the way, all my slides will always have this green dot in between somewhere. The green dot means that's a guideline slide. So in case you want to just zip off whatever I have told, go to the slide sorter view and pick up those green dot slides, take them out, and you are done. Okay. So use minimum fonts, 2 are enough. So 2 doesn't mean that you have the presentation in Times Roman and Comic Sans at the end. It's not required. You can do it for your heading and subheading kind of thing. Use the options to emphasize, but don't use more than font options for emphasizing. use the alignment feature. Nowadays, every other software comes with a grid feature. Please use the grid. I've seen people doing some very stupid things, and I don't want to use this word, but people are using spacebar to centralize a text and all that, which is really hard. Because if I want to edit it also, it's not getting left aligned now because of the spaces in between. I have to delete those spaces and only then it will get left aligned. So please, please, please use the affordances of the tools which are available to you and don't spend time on that. Fine, go next. Okay, so this is the same thing I was just telling, that commonly committed blunders, elements placed without layouts, just hanging around in PowerPoint presentations especially, and too many fonts, and images are chosen which are not coherent with the content. So, and for that, you should go and have a look at the lecture video number 1 on visual presentation, where I talk elaborately about types of content mapped to types of visuals. So that will, I think, give you a fair amount of idea about for what content, what visual should be used. And if we have questions, we can stick it up on the discussion forum probably, but not now. We'll go ahead. This is about the visual effects on the presentation. So people have transitions and I just spoke about it, but let's go ahead. So people have so many transitions in between that at the end of the presentation, you are confused about when, on what is this whole thing started off. You just forget the first slide of that because you are just taken away from the content so much. So what is the guideline for the impress part? How do you impress? So the first slide, you remember, plan, execute, impress. So these are the guidelines for the impress part. So you want the audience to take away whatever you are saying. That is the goal of, right? Next. What you don't want and you will never want. What you never want is the audience being taken away by the communication, whatever you are doing. And this kind of things, bizarre fonts, vivid colors, and really disturbing transitions and all that, really take away the audience itself from you rather than the communication. So don't use that at all. Go next. So all this debate is basically about the famous words of form and function. Go next. So this is the definition in a very poor man's language. What is form and function? This is a big debate all over the place. So form is how do you show the message, and function is what is the message. Now let us take an example for that. Go next. So if I tell you the message is, or the product is, bunch of bristles to either clean or apply, it is restored back. Okay, mild heart attack hota hai, I can realize that. Okay. So I was saying about bunch of bristles to either clean or apply. If that is the message, then what could be the form of that? How will you communicate that? So any answers? Brush, right? Okay, go next slide. Yes, brush is the correct answer. Chennai, Loyola, I can see your answer, brush. But when I give you further context, and this is again connecting back to this chunking example TPS, what we did, that more I give you context, you can come up with more options, right? We're more specific options. So if I tell you teeth, then toothbrush, right? Go next. And if I tell you face, then go next. What is the face brush? So girls typically say makeup brush and boys typically say shaving brush. And that's common, right? It's again contextual. When you say face, please specify whether it is for ladies or gents. Okay, fine. Go next. And if it is paper, everybody is very clear that it has to be a painting brush, right? So this is the point I'm trying to make, is that when you have a function which is chiseled out, but unless until you contextualize that function, the form is not going to take a proper shape. You possibly, even though the message will be that bunch of bristles to clean or apply is correct, the function is set, but you cannot think of using a painting brush to clean your teeth, right? The form is not matching the requirement. So therefore, just try and introspect wherever you have tried to use certain visuals, certain fonts, certain colors, which were not suitable for that particular context is where you have lost the connect with the audience. Go next. One more. Right. Therefore, this is my take on this debate on form over function. There is nothing like this is important and that is not important. Both are equally important. However, when inadequate attention is paid to one of them, then it will create an ineffective communication. A very good content, bad design, right? It is ineffective. On the other side, excellent design, bad content, right? So excess attention to either of them will again result into chaos. So too many fonts, too many colors, too many photographs and backgrounds and transitions and all that. No impact because chaos, right? Go next. So this is how I use it. So first I think of what is the content, who is the target audience and what is it saying? What is the function of that? Once I know, I contextualize it and then content for that given audience should govern the decision of choosing the following: the informative visual, the appropriate design and the suitable strategy of sharing it, right? So yeah. Okay, so what are the takeaways? Let the content and application decide the use of mediums. So don't choose that first and then backtrack it to this. Second, follow well-researched guidelines, and there are plenty of so don't worry about inventing them. Just think of something you want to do. Go ahead, search, get them, validate them from somewhere and then use it as it is. One of the examples is those green dots, right? So just in case you have forgotten by the time, I want to reinforce. And final thing is test before doing it. Remember that Mr. Murphy will attack anytime, anywhere, like it attacked just now. Right? So you have a battery going off and you should carry a spare battery. And in fact, I remember Professor Fatak carrying a spare battery for all the gadgets he uses, because this is something beyond your control. You can't think of that, but you have to be prepared for that. If you want to do a good presentation, you have to have your each and everything tested multiple times before doing it. And that is where the practice also comes in, because all this timing and everything will be dependent on that. Okay, let us just go next. Mr. Murphy. Okay, so this is Sardar Patel. Murphy is the famous laws of Murphy, where whatever can go wrong will go wrong, is that law. And so if the battery can go off, it will go off when you are presenting. If the camera can fall down, it will fall down. So you be sure that you have a proper hand and it is locked. You have a person to hold the camera on the other side. All these things are part of the taking care thing. So I hope I have answered your query. Okay, so Theme College of Engineering is complimenting me, saying that excellent session amongst all. Fine, good. I am thankful to you. But I would also remind you that it is not the end of the session. I am coming up with another set of slides. In between NMIT Bangalore, if Professor Fatak is around, let us try and go and talk to him. In between, we will come up with the second part of the session. IIT Bombay, can you please coordinate this flow transfer? In the meantime, please take down the contacts. I have seen a lot of people actually looking at this website, and I got a pointer suddenly yesterday saying that your website visits have just shot up like anything. So please take it down, most of our content. Okay, you can select them from your site. Fine. So we have to only put them. Is the full stop and comma compulsory while using a bullet? Okay, so wait, there is something. RC Patel Institute of Technology, Shirpur, Dhule is asking, is full stop or comma compulsory while using bullet? Acha, they mean to say that if I write bullet number one followed by bullet number two, is it required to use a comma there or a full stop there? Okay, what is the local answer here? Let us check that. No. How many people say no? But no to what? Comma or full stop? Both. Both are not required. Okay, Dhule, both are not required. Why? Bullet is a okay. So bullets are separated by distance, and it's on the second line. Therefore, no comma, no full stop. Any other answer? They are two separate points. So that is why they say you want a full stop. You have two separate sentences separated with a full stop, isn't it? So if they are two separate points, they should be separated with a full stop. And if it is a continuous point, then it should be separated with a comma. So they are right in their question actually. Can you come up with a better argument? You can write your phrases, okay. Not complete sentence, okay. So here is another argument. So these, I am digressing into English grammar right now, but please hold on. So when you write bullets in a presentation, you are not, so first thing, which very important point she made is that don't write sentences. Write phrases, short words. No sentence should exceed 6 words. And I have covered that in my video actually. So fine. But then if it is a phrase, so for example, I am writing 20 types of color pigments. Then I'll separate them with commas. Then why are you not allowing me to type a comma there now? This is a bang on answer. So if you are writing continuous on the same line, like horizontal row and columns, if we talk about, if you are on the same line, then separation is required. So you do it with a comma. But when you put a enter and a new circle, square, or a heart shape, whatever bullet you are using for your own reasons, if that comes up and then you write some other phrases, that separating those lines and this starting point is good enough for telling the user that this is a new topic altogether. And because they are one below the other, they are connected is the assumption we are making. And because it is on the separate line, it is not part of that same phrase, is also another message we are giving out. Am I clear? Or is something to be added? Okay. So Shirpur Dhule, are you satisfied with this answer? How many lines should a slide have? Okay, so Jammu and Kashmir has this question, and please refer to the video number 1 in visual presentation where I have actually given this as a guideline slide also. Unfortunately, I didn't carry it in this presentation, but yes, it is there. Anyone else? Thanks a lot. Yes. By the way, you all will be happy to note that Shirpur has agreed with our argument. We'll go, okay. Can you please upload the lecture series of Dr. Sahasrabuddhi on presentations, all the videos in the series that were posted on Flip session? Okay. I don't know what is this. Anyway, maybe you can write to me separately. Okay. Professor Fatek is available. So let us go over to NMIT Bangalore. Yes. Center number is 1105.
I'm going to visit for so many years. I have the principal of the institute with me, and we have the participants. I have not yet interacted with them, but when you break at 1 o'clock, I'll talk to them. As I was telling all our 7,000 participants that I am delighted to see the enthusiasm of such a large number of faculty colleagues to adopt, learn and adopt these new technology for a more effective and higher quality education. I will not interfere with the ongoing discussions. Suffice it to say that communication is a fundamental resource available to us through which we can motivate our students. And visual communication is what we often do whenever we conduct our conventional lectures. While we are suggesting strongly that we should adopt the flipped classroom, it is not possible for all of us to switch over immediately. Over the next 3 to 5 years, we all will be in a flux where we will have to continue to conventionally teach and also adopt technology slowly. During this process, I believe the proper understanding of the best way to communicate, particularly emphasizing the right aspects of visual communication for which, unfortunately, none of us have ever been trained. I remember when the PowerPoint first came, all of us were so enamored that we started pushing much of the material on PowerPoint slides, making slides so busy that even we could not read them properly, forget the students. So that is when I started saying that, as people say, power corrupts. I said PowerPoint corrupts absolutely, unless you are very careful about how to use it. So I am happy that my colleague Dr. Samir Sastrabuddhe is conducting this session, and without further ado, I'll hand you back to him. Over to you.
Thank you, sir.